Thank you. Thanks for the invitation. I have not an easy task. The first, because I have to convince Isabel. She was convinced by my antagonist. The second is because, in general, it's not easy to say no. So I was in trouble, and I Googled how to say no. I found 11 possibilities. Some of them are acceptable, others are quite difficult. And then I find a paper, The Power of a Positive No, Save the Deal, Save the Relationship, and Still Say No. I will follow this approach. And I try to be rational. Why? We are interested on the question whether AF can prevent stroke. For a practical reason, to have the possibility to withdraw OSC after AF ablation in patients who are at risk after some months. And I wrote a series of questions that I tried to answer in order to find the possibility to give a definite answer to the question. I will list, I will review them, starting from number one. Does AF ablation cure AF or just control AF? In other terms, is there a residual risk of AF-related stroke that remains among patients treated with AF ablation? And we have to stress that we are 20 years after the pioneering experience of Isager. At that time, the use of ablation was completely different from nowadays. We were in the left part of this slide. AF ablation was a rescue treatment applied for very hard symptoms, and there was a high threshold for the indication. Nowadays, the option which is attractive is to use AF as a cure to improve symptoms, but possibly also for eliminating morbidity. So the possibility is to propose AF with a low threshold. But now, if we look to the few randomized trials we have this paper from Cosedis Nielsen, patient with paroxysmal AF, a comparison of ablation versus antiarrhythmic as a first-line therapy. There is no difference at long term in the cumulative burden of AF, no significant differences. So some AF remains, some residual risk of AF-related stroke remains despite ablation in the general population treated. And we also have this data from Cabana. The data are not published, but this composite endpoint did not reach the significance in favor of ablation. We also can analyze this other endpoint of Cabana. There is a benefit of ablation versus drug, but 50% of the patients still present recurrences despite ablation. So a residual risk remains. So rather than to say that ablation is a cure of atrial fibrillation, we have to say that today is a strategy to control atrial fibrillation. Some AF remains, some residual risk remains. And this is stressed also by this post-hoc additional analysis of Cabana based on Holter. We have the burden at long-term, a benefit as compared to drugs, but still more than 50% of the patient have AF recurrences despite ablation. So some residual risk remains. Second point, does the post-ablation atrial remodeling implies a normal mechanical function? This is an important component of the prothrombotic state of AF. Stasis implies thrombogenicity. There are a few papers on the mechanical function after ablation. This is from Ann Arbor. There was an assessment of the left atrial ejection fraction before and after circumferential ablation, and we have the ejection fraction in control patients, paroxysmal AF before, after, chronic AF, even after ablation, we don't have a normal function of the left atrium. So the conclusion of this interesting study is that we can have normal sinus rhythm after ablation, but not normal atrium. We have a decrease in left atrial size, but not a fully normal function despite an effective ablation. There are meta-analyses on this. This was published years ago. Before and after ablation, the difference does not achieve significance. Measuring left atrial ejection fraction, other indices have been proposed. Obviously, there is a difference between paroxysmal and persistent AF, but no major difference in not normal function in these analyses. So the so-called Virchow triad is not in favor of considering that ablation nullifies the prothrombotic state that is associated with AF. Third point, could we rely on absence of AF for some months for withdrawing oral anticoagulation after AF ablation? This is an important point. Surely we cannot rely on symptoms because we have a reduction of symptoms after ablation, even if a continuous monitoring can document AF. So this was the basis for proposing recording through loop recorders of what happened after ablation, your ablation time. Some patients have ablation of AF, other some recurrences. So the rationale for an approach guided by documentation of AF recurrences, even asymptomatic, may mean that discontinuation of anticoagulation is proposed to patients who have no burden of AF, while some burden, if some burden is recognized, there's immediate reinitiation of anticoagulation. Does this strategy works? We have data suggesting that it was applied. These are data from Themistoclakis, discontinuation in patients without antiarrhythmic recurrences, without severe pulmonary stenosis, without severe left atrial dysfunction. These are data published in literature. However, in another setting, patient implanted with ICD and CRTD, we have a randomized trial where in the intervention group, the absence of any AF for some days, 30 days if low chats, 90 days if high chats, led to withdrawal of anticoagulation. And this intervention group was compared to another group where anticoagulation was continued independently on the documentation of presence absence of AF. The study was negative. No differences in this composite of stroke, systemic embolus, major bleeding. And if we analyze in detail the data, there was no difference even in major bleeding. So the strategy of on and off of anticoagulation according to presence absence of AF was not effective. It's a different setting, but the finding is important. We have also to stress that patients who have history of AF can have stroke even when they are in sinus rhythm. This is our data from Isabel, the RACE study among the group of patients who had thromboembolic events. Six patients had events after cessation of warfarin, and five of them were in sinus rhythm. So it was history of AF that conditioned the rhythm, and the stroke occurred in sinus rhythm. So this leads to another point. Does absence of AF implies no substantial risk of AF-associated stroke that could benefit for your C? So we go back to the point if AF is simply a risk factor or can also be a marker. This is an important point. Again, from the device studies, there were patients implanted with CAD who had the occurrence of a stroke, and the red line implies the stroke. All these patients had AF detected prior to stroke, as documented by the device, but if we analyze the 30 days before the stroke, there was a surprise. Close to 50% of them did not have any atrial tachyarrhythmia in the preceding 30 days. And if we analyze this point in detail, we have here a summary of a series of studies with CIED, more than 200 strokes. AFAT at any time before stroke was documented in a percentage between 13 and 2/3. AFAT in the 30 days before stroke, between 6 and 30%, but AF during stroke in very low percentages, 2 to 27%. So in patients with who had AF, there is a temporal dissociation between the occurrence of stroke and the documentation of AF. So there are important points to consider. Short episodes of AF are associated with stroke TIA, SER data. Stroke may occur at temporal distance of AF. So the relationship between AF and stroke is much more difficult than what we expected. It's not only, not only AF as cause of stroke, as a risk factor, but probably AF also as a marker of stroke with a simple relationship of association without a cause and effect relationship. In other words, AF can be like Janus, who was a Roman god with two faces. It can be a direct cardioembolic factor when there are cardioemboli, but it can also be simply a marker of risk with atheroemboli for the aorta from a cerebrovascular disease or atrial cardiomyopathy being the substrate. So a much more difficult and intriguing relationship between AF and stroke, AF leading to stroke, but other factors associated with AF which can may lead to stroke per se, first of all, atrial cardiomyopathy, but also aging and comorbidities. And indeed, this consensus statement indicates that decision regarding continuation of systemic anticoagulation more than 2 months post ablation should be based on the patient's stroke, risk of stroke, and not on the perceived success or failure of the ablation. This is a class one recommendation. To use continuous monitoring is only a class 2B recommendation. Final point, do we have solid evidence, at least one randomized controlled study trial, to suggest that we can withdraw oral anticoagulation in patients at risk? Because AF ablation suppresses long-term risk of AF-associated stroke. The answer is easy, is no. Also, my antagonist says this. We have registries. Some of them are of good quality. I will show some different registries compared to my antagonist. This is from Sweden. Some patients with chest VAS more than 2 withdraw warfarin. The result was a higher occurrence of stroke, higher risk as compared to patients who continued to take warfarin. Here a list, a figure of the patients who discontinued warfarin along the time, obviously patient with a low CHA2DS2-VASc, but also patient with an higher CHA2DS2-VASc. And here, the Kaplan-Meier curve of the occurrence of ischemic stroke, the risk of withdrawing warfarin when CHA2DS2-VASc was equal or higher than 2 was 4.6. So it is a risky strategy. And let's try to go on, but there are. This is another data set where warfarin was withdrawn in some cases, but if the withdrawal was after more than 1 year for ablation in patients with CHA2DS2-VASc, this led to a marked increase in the risk of stroke. So withdrawing warfarin can be risky. We have meta-analysis. This is a very recent meta-analysis from Riccardo Proietti, 10 prospective core studies and 6 retrospective core studies. The relative risk of cerebrovascular events in this analysis is not different with OSC off and OSC on. There is an advantage if in terms of bleeding, because withdrawing oral anticoagulation lowers the risk of major bleeding. But if we look at this data, and this is a study already shown by my antagonist, we can find studies where, on the basis of administrative codes, patients were compared. This study showed a much better outcome for patients treated with ablation as compared to patients without ablation, similar to the normal population. The only matching was based on age and gender. This is a risky approach. I go to the end. I'm not, it's not an easy work. Matching should be done with several factors, type of AF. It was not done in the paper by Freiberg, and you show how different can be the outcome in according to the different populations. This is the Swedish registry. This is the Framingham population, completely different outcome. So many factors should be considered in matching. And if we consider, if we rely on, on observational study, we can have a paradox. This is a study on ICD, where the finding was that defibrillator reduces hip fractures. The reason is that there is a measure confounding that justifies the result. So we can have very bad results if we do not consider what happens. I'm going to the end. In literature, there are many studies showing the risk of a confounding that is not known. So my final answer is that waiting for the randomized trial that like East and Ocean, we have to say no. I would love to say yes, but not at this time. We are dealing with stroke. We need to be quite cautious, and some doubt is needed in this difficult set of patients. Thank you.